бананы, надати ще більше допомоги.
Чи кількість невинних жертв.
В Канаді не повинні в цей час проводити далі бізнеси російські підприємства, які фінансово підтримують Путіна і його аморальну війну. Закликаємо провінцію Манітоби надати Україні значно більше гуманітарної допомоги і бути готовими прийняти кільканадцять тисяч біженців з України на тимчасовій і на постійній базі. В кінці звертаємось до громадян Манітоби. Просимо всіх молитися за Україну і за український народ. Пишіть до своїх депутатів, вимагайте, щоб вони стали в обороні демократії і правовладдя в Україні. І тих, хто має можливість, просимо зложити свої щирі пожертви на гуманітарний фонд, створений спільно Конгресом українців Канади і Канадською українською фундацією. Обидві організації мають за собою позитивну історію допомоги Україні. Будьте запевнені, що всі зібрані гроші будуть передані на гуманітарну допомогу в Україну. І зібраних дотепер коштів вже передано в Україну майже 1 600 000 доларів. Як бачите, по моїй лівій стороні стоять декілька столів, де можна підписати листи до своїх депутатів, дізнатися більше про гуманітарний фонд «Прикув» і зложити свою пожертву чи закупити речі, прихід з яких йде на допомогу Україні. Просимо після офіційної програми ними поцікавитися. Слава Україні! Слава Україні!
I now call on Most Reverend Metropolitan Lawrence Hutsulak, head of the Ukrainian Catholic Church in Canada, to lead us in prayer.
Що вони радше керувалися любов'ю до беззахисних, аніж ненавистю до ворогів. Опримилосердний Господи, захорони переселенців, ціли поранених, борони сиріт, підтримай вдів, потіш скорботних та ласкаво прийми до Твого царства всіх, хто благородно віддав своє життя в обороні Батьківщини від нападів ворогів. Поспіши зупинити кровопролиття, як друга, так і на друга, та запали серця багатьох до мужньої боротьби за істинну справедливість, що є джерелом тривалого миру. O Lord Jesus Christ, our God, we entreat you to hear the earnest prayer of your people, for her deep, the people of Ukraine, for her deeply afflicted children abiding in the land of Ukraine. Behold their grave sorrow and grievous plight, and speedily come to their aid. Deliver your vulnerable people from unjust aggressors, foreign invasion, and the terror of war. Strengthen courageous defenders of the nation to fight virtuously, inspired more by love of those they protect than hatred of the enemy. O compassionate Lord, shelter the displaced, heal the wounded, console the orphan, protect the widow, comfort those who mourn, and mercifully receive into your kingdom those who have nobly died guarding their homeland against every aggression. Quickly make cease the spilling of blood of friend and foe alike, yet stir many to bravely struggle for that true justice which alone can bring lasting peace. O kind-hearted Lord, as you are our peace, soften the hearts of the unmerciful and convert those who promise hostilities toward reconciliation.
so that your beloved children of the land of Ukraine may abide in that tranquility, justice, and freedom which reflects your kingdom, where you reign with your eternal Father, your most holy Son and life-giving Spirit, now and forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
З українців Канади. Надбудова, яка об'єднує 20 українських організацій міста Вінніпегу. Виступить її президент Іванка Левандовська, Джоан Левандовський. Прошу.
Дякую. Дорогі друзі, dear friends, day 11 and counting, the world is appalled at the atrocities occurring in Ukraine. We all want peace, but what is happening in Ukraine is Russian-sponsored terrorism. Governments and non-governmental organizations alike are doing what they can to help Ukraine, but the need is so great. The World Health Organization has announced that it is running out of funds. In some cases, for example, in Kharkiv, Russian forces are preventing humanitarian aid from getting in. Mayor Andriy Sadovy of Kyiv publicly requests more non-lethal help. Helmets and body armor are desperately needed for protecting defenders. Vivana Frankiewicz-Prushvita is gathering humanitarian aid to transport to Kyiv and reports a serious lack of medical supplies. We are indeed grateful for all that is being done, but Ukraine needs more help today and now. Last count was more than 2,000 civilians dead, but updated numbers are not yet available, and the death count is undoubtedly far greater. Ukraine stands between Putin and the free world. Our governments need to do more. More military and humanitarian aid. Additional sanctions on Putin and his oligarchs. A ban on Russian businesses in the West that are feeding Putin's war machine. And immediate help for the displaced, primarily those poor women and those children who are fleeing into neighboring countries. We cannot stand idle. Now is the time to come up to the plate and offer greater assistance. I take this opportunity to thank the Premier for once again facilitating this event at the Manitoba Legislature, and to Minister Vandel and Deputy Mayor Chambers for their participation today. Thank you to Metropolitan Lawrence Hutsulak, and to all of today's speakers, Professor Miroslav Shkandry and Nick Kravats. And most of all, I express our heartfelt gratitude to each and every one of you and to the committee of young people, including our two MCs, who have worked so diligently to bring today's event to fruition. They are our future. Slava Ukraini, Heroyam Slava! Glory to Ukraine, glory to our heroes. Дякую.
Слава Україні!
Героям слава!
Associate Professor Emeritus of the Department of German and Slavic Studies at the University of Manitoba, respected author and historian Dr. Miroslav Shkandli to provide some brief remarks. Professor Shkandli.
Friends and supporters of Ukraine, as we watch the destruction, the bombing of cities and civilians, we have to ask ourselves why. Putin gives three reasons, all of them patently false. First, the claim that the Ukrainian government is run by Nazis and drug addicts. This is obviously absurd. Volodymyr Zelensky, who has performed brilliantly as a wartime president, is Jewish. He lost his family during the Holocaust. 73% of the population elected him, and he has the full support of Ukraine's citizens. Whatever their race, religion, or ethnic background, they have mobilized to resist the invaders. Second, the claim that NATO is threatening Russia. The reason why the Baltic states, Poland, Hungary, and other East European countries asked to join the alliance after 1991 is because they remember being dominated by Moscow. Russian tanks rolled into Budapest in 1956, into Prague in 1968. There are constant violations today of airspace and cyber attacks against the Baltic states. East European countries have every right to their own security. Today, majorities of citizens in Finland and Sweden favor joining. As for Ukraine, it is not a member of the alliance. It gave up its nuclear weapons in 1994 at the Budapest Agreement in return for security guarantees from the US, the UK, Russia. Russia broke those guarantees. It invaded Ukraine in 2014 and has now done so again in 2022. Third, the argument that Russian speakers in Ukraine are oppressed. It is clear now that the overwhelming majority of Ukrainians, Russian speakers included, support the army, the National Guard, and are fighting fiercely. They're telling Russian troops to stop killing them and go home. They do not want or need Putin's protection. I mention this because viewers of Russian television have heard these arguments for over 8 years. The propaganda has been cynical, dishonest, and relentless. Today, viewers are even told that the bombing of cities is done by Ukrainians themselves. Many ordinary Russians believe this. They have no access to any other sources of information. All media critical of the Kremlin has been shut down. Opposition leaders have been assassinated or imprisoned. Dozens of journalists have been either shot or have mysteriously fallen to their deaths from windows. On the streets of Russia, all demonstrators against the war are arrested. There is now a new law saying that anybody who reports information not taken from an official source faces 15 years in prison. In spite of this, Russians are protesting the war on social media, on the streets. Word is getting back to them about thousands of Russian casualties. Parents are demanding information about conscripted soldiers who are often unwilling to fight. Many have deserted. It is important for us to help this dissenting Russian community, which is growing. They are today the conscience of Russia and wish to bring about regime change. Those who live in zombie land, which is what Ukrainians call Russian TV, are beyond help. They will only change when the catastrophic reality affects them personally. But we need to realize that this zombified population exists. It will cry tears when Putin is removed, in the same way as some Germans cried when they heard of Hitler's death, and many Soviet citizens cried when they learned of Stalin's. Our immediate task is to get the Russian army out of Ukraine. that will end the war. It will immediately stop the carnage and bring peace. As long as the invader is in Ukraine, the war will continue. Sanctions should be extended to all oligarchs and their accounts frozen, because this is where Putin's money is held. If a no-fly zone could be created to prevent blanket bombing and mass murder of civilians, it should be done. When the violence ends, Ukraine will have to be rebuilt. Putin and those responsible for the destruction will be put on trial for crimes against humanity. But what are the real reasons Putin is doing this? Firstly, a democratic, prosperous, and culturally vital Ukraine is a threat to him personally. It presents an attractive alternative to his despotic rule. It's not NATO he fears, it's democracy. Secondly, his modus operandi has always been to respond to setbacks with greater aggression. It's important to keep emphasizing this. He did this in Chechnya in 1999, in Georgia in 2008, in Syria and in Ukraine in 2014, when he annexed Crimea and inflamed the conflicts in the Donbass. But he also has a wider project, shaping Ukraine, Belarus, and Russia into one geopolitical unit, and then challenging the West for leadership of a new world order. He has stated this in websites. In his mind, the new world order will not be built on the West's terms or according to its rules. He spent years building up his army in order to expand Russia's borders and throw down this challenge. The arguments for invasion are a cover for an imperial expansion and an excuse for defying international agreements and rules. It will not work. Ukraine and other threatened nations will resist. They have every right to. Their security matters. Their lives matter. They need our support.
Roosevelt Yagyu, thank you very much, Dr. Shkandri, for your insightful remarks.
I want everyone to turn around to face Broadway. Put all of your signs up into the air. A drone will be taking a photo of us. And together, no more war! 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 High up into the sky! I want all to see all the signs high up! No more war! No more war!
For those who may not know, Червона Калина is the anthem of the Ukrainian siege riflemen of the early 1900s. Brave men who fought courageously for Ukraine's independence. The Red Kalina is revered as a potent national symbol expressive of Ukraine's yearning for freedom. When a Kazakh fell in battle while defending Ukraine, his brothers would lay him to rest in a burial mound, or mohyla, upon which they would plant a kalina bush to honor his sacrifice. We would now like to acknowledge all of the elected officials who are in attendance with us today. Please raise your hands and make your presence known. To bring brief greetings from the province, I call on the Premier of Manitoba, the Honorable Heather Stephenson.
Thank you very much, everyone, and welcome to the Manitoba Legislature today. We're here, obviously, continuing our support for our friends, our family, and our allies in Ukraine. We have announced humanitarian support. We will continue to work with the federal government on expediting immigrants from Ukraine. We will also take in refugees as well. We will do what we can here in Manitoba to support our friends and allies in Ukraine. I want you all to know we have a number of colleagues in the Manitoba Legislature with Ukrainian backgrounds, and I wanted to welcome one of them just to say a few words today. She is no stranger to those in the Ukrainian Manitoba community. She is the MLA for Kildonan River East. Please welcome Kathy Cox.
Slava Ukraini! My heart is full as I stand together in solidarity with all of you today amid a sea of blue and yellow Ukrainian flags to send a strong message to Vladimir Putin that we stand together with Ukraine. We are united in defiance of his cowardly attack on our homeland. The eyes of the world are on our Ukraine, and we are here to tell the people of Ukraine that they are not alone in their fight to protect Ukraine's freedom. We stand with them. Our government stands together with the families of Ukraine. Manitoba has long been the home of hope. It was the home of hope for my mama Gigi and my great-grandparents, who first arrived in Manitoba from Ukraine in the early 1900s. And it remains the home of hope for Ukrainian families forced to flee their Ukrainian homeland. Our Premier and our caucus colleagues are committed to working together with our Ukrainian community to welcome Ukrainian refugees here to Manitoba. We are expediting and prioritizing their immigration applications, and we have committed $150,000 for humanitarian aid, and more is on its way. Ukraine and its people are strong and resilient. They have faced oppression and tyranny, and they have endured the Holodomor, where wheat was used as a weapon by Stalin to starve millions of peaceful Ukrainians. Today, we stand in solidarity to say never again. Never again will we stand idle when cowards like Vladimir Putin defy Ukraine's sovereignty and democracy. And today we stand side by side in defiance of Putin. We are sending a strong message to Putin, to the Putin regime, that never again will evil be victorious over our Ukrainian people. And I would like to express my sincere thank you and thank you to Metropolitan Lawrence for his prayers and blessings. We can never underestimate the power of prayer, and today we pray for those souls of the heroes who lost their lives protecting Ukraine's sovereignty. We pray for their families, and we pray for a peaceful resolution for our Ukraine. The invasion of our Ukraine is not only criminal, but unconscionable. However, even during the darkest times, we see goodness and remarkable acts of kindness. I say Duzha Dakyu to all of you who are raising money, collecting medical supplies, and offering your prayers to Ukraine. And I want to conclude by extending my heartfelt appreciation to the people of Poland and other neighboring countries who have opened their hearts and their homes to nearly 2 million Ukrainian families forced from their homes. We stand proud with Ukraine. Slava Ukraini!
I would now like to invite Minister Smith to speak briefly. Thank you.
Good day, Dobry den. Thank you all for being here today to show your unwavering support for a free and sovereign Ukraine. Thank you to the Ukrainian Canadian Congress for organizing these rallies in support for a nation that's under siege. What we are witnessing today in Ukraine is horrific. The sovereign, brave, and free people of Ukraine once again find themselves living in uncertainty and fighting for their very existence. Families are being displaced, communities communities torn apart and precious and innocent lives lost. This is unacceptable, and the government of Manitoba, in fact all Manitobans, strongly condemn this heinous crime against humanity. As a Canadian and Manitoban myself, I know that I was fortunate to be born in this country, but it's through no doing of my own. I owe my very being here largely to my Ukrainian grandparents, who were displaced from their homeland of Ukraine. They were refugees after the Second World War, and through a series of events, came to this beautiful province we call Manitoba. Growing up, they would tell me stories and struggles through the Ukrainian, or stories of their struggle in Ukraine. My grandmother was a Holodomor survivor who reminded me of how important it is to be, and how fortunate we are to live in this country, Canada. But she always, always dreamed of permanent peace in Ukraine. And while there's been much progress since the fall of the Soviet Union, the last 2 weeks have reversed that and jeopardized that lasting peace. So I want to thank every one of you here today for all that you're doing. Slava Ukraini! Slava Ukraini! Glory to Ukraine. Back to you.
Now representing the federal government, we have with us today the Honourable Dan Vandel, Minister of Northern Affairs and Member of Parliament for St. Boniface, St. Vital.
Good afternoon, dear friends. Bon après-midi, chers amis. I'm joined by Kevin Lamoureux, Member of Parliament for Winnipeg North. And it's heartwarming to see so many people here today once again. I'm here today with you in solidarity for all of you who stand with Ukraine. Russia's unprovoked attacks are a clear and further violation of Ukraine's sovereignty, territorial integrity, and independence. Putin's war on Ukraine is a war on freedom, it's a war on democracy, and on the rights of Ukrainians and all people to determine their own future. I know that many of you here today are worried about family and friends back in Ukraine or having fled to neighboring countries for safety. This week, Canada announced a new program where an unlimited number of Ukrainians will be able to come to Canada with an expedited emergency visa for up to 2 years. There is no limit to how many Ukrainians Canada is willing to accept. And for those wanting to make Canada their permanent home, we're introducing an expedited path to permanent residency for Ukrainians seeking to reunite with family members who are already in Canada. But there is much, much more to do. As I said last weekend, this is a dark time for Ukraine and the world. We are working with our allies. We are working with the United States. We are working with NATO. And we are exploring all options to respond to the acceleration by Russia of this crisis, as we will counter their real threats, European security and world security. Kevin Lamoureux would like to say a few quick words.
Whether it's happening in downtown Winnipeg, in communities across Canada, or all around the world, people are saying in solidarity, Putin, get the hell out of Ukraine! We have a very special relationship between Canada and Ukraine. It's a relationship that has been there in the past today, and it will be there into the future years. We understand the emotions that people in Canada, in North End Winnipeg, in the city, the province, the experiences that we are witnessing every day in the news, the horrors of what's happening in Ukraine. We want you to know that politicians of all political stripes have united to ensure that Canada continues to be there for Ukraine and the people of Ukraine. That is something that is going to happen. We will be there. Thank you so much for coming out. Long live Ukraine.
Thank you very much. While Mayor Bowman cannot be with us today, bringing greetings from the city of Winnipeg is the Deputy Mayor, Artis Chambers, Councillor for St. Norbert and St. River City.
Good afternoon and welcome to the steps of the Manitoba Legislature. I'm honored as the Deputy Mayor to share a few words on behalf of the City of Winnipeg. I had the opportunity to welcome Winnipeg's Ukrainian community to City Hall and raise the flag, the Ukrainian flag, celebrating 30 years of independence on August 21st, 2021. Ukraine has been independent since August 21st, 1991, and must remain so, even as we see the news emanating from the region. I'm glad to see how many people have come out this afternoon in solidarity with our brothers and sisters from the Ukraine. We all raise flags here today and speak in unison with our vibrant Ukrainian community here in Winnipeg and throughout Manitoba and across the world, dedicated to the preservation of independence. In remembering the Ukrainian independence, we acknowledge the freedom fighters of 1991. Who were allowed to regain their sovereignty and autonomy, as we also acknowledge the brave men and women and children who are fighting to maintain that very same independence from a populist and authoritarian regime. Meanwhile, here in Winnipeg, we continue to support our Ukrainian independence as we continue to acknowledge the vital contributions made by our Ukrainian community, which was one of the earliest settlements in our province. Manitoba was easily the most significant Canadian province in terms of Ukrainian settlement. I'm strongly supportive of all of the efforts of all three levels of government who continue to provide actionable support to the people of Ukraine. Our mayor has reached out to the mayor of Kiev and the mayor of Lviv, our sister city, offering unwavering support. Our provincial government has extended the use of the Manitoba Provincial Nominee Program to bring Ukrainian families here to Manitoba. And our federal government has stepped up its efforts to impose strict sanctions to cripple the Russian economy. Quite simply put, Putin must be put out. Winnipeg will always be a welcoming home to immigrants who are seeking a better future. The Ukrainian community has been among successful immigrant groups wanting to preserve and promote their Ukrainian culture here in our province and city. Winnipeg will always have great significance to the settlement of Ukrainians here in Canada. And accordingly, we will struggle with all of you to preserve Ukrainians' independence. Your struggle is our struggle. Your pain is our pain. Your fight is our fight. Your victory to maintain and sovereignty of Ukraine will be a triumph heard around the world. Slava Ukraine! We continue to thank you and your valued contributions to enhancing the quality of life here in the city of Winnipeg and throughout the province and throughout the world. Thank you, merci, and j'appuie.
Яка вже роками працює, щоб Канада відкрила безвізовий в'їзд для українців. Молодий канадець Микола Кравець. Не Кравець, а long-time champion for visa-free entry to Canada from Ukraine, will briefly explain this issue.
Слава Україні! immigration, refugees, and citizenship on Thursday will provide greater flexibility, and they are a positive step forward. We are grateful. However, these new pathways will not be open for applications for at least another 2 weeks. At that time, people will still have to deal with bureaucracy. Asking people to wait 2 weeks while missiles are landing on them is nonsense. While existing mechanisms are all very available now for Ukrainians who desire a safe haven in Canada until this nightmare ends. The fastest, safest, and most efficient way for Ukrainians to come to Canada is to waive the temporary visa requirement by adding Ukraine to the exemption list.
Help our loved ones. Slava Ukraini! Yeah.